there were two.
No reason to
My apologies to everyone. There were two digital failures on the way to Digital Humanities Asia, and so that's fitting. So welcome to the third installation of DH Asia. It is a great honor to introduce our speaker for today, who is actually, this is a homecoming of sorts. We were lucky enough many years ago to have Hilde with us for a year, a very, very productive year. As I remember, I distinctly remember a conversation at Coupa in which you had just informed me that you submitted something in the order of 8 or 9 journal articles and book chapters, and I said, how in the world did that happen? And you simply turned to me and said, well, I just decided it was time. I had them in the works. And if you look over her CV from, I think, from the years 2010, 11, 12, you can see the manifestations of that. So this is the third installation of DH Asia for the public lecture. And as always, Hilde will be with us over the course of really 3 days. Today is the public lecture, which we're all looking forward to. And then on Thursday, a number of you have already signed up for the workshop, the hands-on workshop, which I believe now is actually at capacity. I'm sorry if you haven't registered yet, but that just goes to show how long we've been looking forward to your visit. So today's talk, as you see, is Digital Perspectives on Imperial Chinese Political History, and then on Thursday, the hands-on workshop will actually be our opportunity to roll up our sleeves and to dig into the digital platform that Hilde and her colleagues have been pioneering at Leiden University, where she is professor of history. And so without any further ado and any more digital mix-ups,
I hope I can turn the odds from now on. Well, thanks very much for having me. This it has been a wonderful experience so far. It's nice to be able to do not one, but two talks, and also to talk a little bit about methodology in addition to talking about some of the things that I have been working on the last couple of years. I picked a fairly broad topic for this talk, in part because this is the stage at which I am, that I finished the book, and what you see here in front of you is a cover of it. But I'm also moving into a couple of related projects that came out of some of the digital methodologies that I started developing as I worked towards the end of this project. There is an overarching question that I have been dealing with, and that is mostly the question of how informal networks impact on the course of Chinese political history, and more specifically on political imaginaries. And even though I'll be talking about three cases, I think that you will see that this is the recurring theme. At the same time, because this is tied to the workshop that Tom just referred to, I also thought that it would be suitable to make some reflections on methodology as well, and what the use might be of including digital approaches to classical Chinese text. So I'll be making a couple of references to scaling in particular. Scaling up from fragmentary textual references to the reconstruction of communication networks, but also scaling down from entire correspondence sets to particular letters, to the sorts of things that we might be interested in. And then towards the end, also looking at the possibility of doing research on entire collectivities, on political parties, involving sometimes dozens, but in one case also hundreds of people. Some of this is still in progress, under development, and I look forward to hearing your feedback on that. To start out with the first project, basically what I have been trying to do in this book and in some of what will follow up on this as well is to map out what I would call a structural transformation of political communication takes place in 12th century China in particular. And then I'm talking mainly about Southern Song China. Some of the roots of this development go back to the late 11th century, but the loss of the northern territories in the 1120s was really a defining moment in consolidating some of the trends that I will be talking about. I will be hydrating myself from time to time because I came down with a bit of a cold, so apologies for that ahead of time. And essentially what I mean by this structural transformation in political communication is that up until the late 11th century, most information that relates to government, to the state, talking about maps, mapping of borders, but also the interior territories, archival combinations, court gazettes, the kinds of news sheets documenting important decisions at court, military geographies, all sorts of genres that we can relate to information about the state. Most of this was produced by courts, commissions, or by people associated with high court positions. And it was also produced for that audience, for emperors and high court officials. Starting in the late 11th century, a shift begins to take place where many of these genres are adapted, modified, produced, and also consumed for a literati audience. And a lot of this, of course, takes place within a context of significant social cultural changes having to do with the important ways, the establishment of the civil service examinations, in first instance as an important way to government service, but also later on when it isn't necessarily the main way to get a job in government, it is also an important way to document status, to become part of the cultured elite. So an example of, well, actually, I might, since I already did this for some of you, I might explain perhaps on it, because in some ways the cover tells you the story of the entire book, so you can save yourself reading 400 pages or so by thinking about what is on here. What you see on the left-hand side is a commercial reproduction, most likely, but also certainly an adaptation of an archival compilation of important decisions, edicts, memorials that were submitted under the reigns of the first two sovereign Song emperors, Emperors Kaozong and Xiaozong. You can see that this was prepared for a literati audience because, as you see in the top there, the top register, you see topical headings that were meant to guide readers towards the sorts of things that they might be interested in. Now, I picked this particular heading for a good reason. Hu Wang Hui Fu means do not forget the restoration, or perhaps more accurately, do not forget the recovery. And the recovery refers to the recovery of the northern territories that had fallen in the hands of the Jurchens. And this was a motivating force for this trend that I'm describing, the idea that literati attention had to be focused on mobilizing resources, also mobilizing the political will for the recovery of these territories. On the right-hand side, you see an example of what this meant in the realm of cartography. There is, for the first time, actually, we have a variety of maps showing all of the Chinese territories. We know these maps existed before. Most likely, they go back to at least the reign of the first emperor of Qin. But at that point, most likely because they were monumental and for a limited audience, only they didn't survive. The earliest examples that do survive all date from this time period, 12th century. And we have many of them on steles, but also, as in this example, printed and printed by commercial publishers. What's remarkable about those is that they all kind of look like this, particularly when they're covering all the Chinese territories. There's certainly regional mappings as well, particularly in the military arena, but the ones that cover all of the Chinese territories never show the geography as it would have looked at the time. That is to say, the north being governed by the Jurchens, the south by the Song. Instead, it consistently shows a what we might call a trans-historical Chinese territory that included also the areas that were most contested. For example, those territories that were under Liao occupation at the time were also considered to be part of this normative realm. So that is sort of the story that it tries to tell. But I want to start out actually in documenting this transition, structural transformation of political communication, by retracing the transmission history of one observation that I think it's also a question that one of the foremost historians of the 11th century, but perhaps in Chinese history more generally, Sima Guang down. The problem itself is also at the core of a lot of what I'm interested in, but I think also what motivated literati to get involved in the production and also the reading of court materials. In 1061, so Sima Guang, in a memorial to Emperor Renzong, in which he wanted to encourage him to focus on investing in border affairs. At this point, the Tangu Qia and also the Liao were posing challenges. And he reinforced this point that if you look at Chinese history up till that point, along the way kind of perspective, there had only been 500 years or so in which the Chinese territories had been united. For most of its history, the history was actually a story of multi-state rule. So it was an important moment, because it also presented a very different model of using history to think about administration. At the time, and actually the task that Sima Guang was set when he wrote this memorial was to compile an encyclopedia of cases, because using cases was a way of using history to solve administrative problems. You can think of very prominent examples like the one that I showed just a minute ago. You provide topics, provide a couple cases, and that allowed for sort of reasoning with examples to come to your conclusion. Sima Guang very self-consciously advocated for a model in which trends should be looked at in a long durée sort of way over the course of hundreds of years, because those patterns impacted the way things were. And so in order to change things, it was important to get a sense as to where they came from over time. And this was very much part of this effort. But at the time when he wrote this memorial and this important line, he very much also sort of sounded a congratulatory note. He also said, well, you know, so far, 1061, you know, the first 100 years or so, or certainly the first 80 years of Tang rule had been fairly peaceful, and by and large, this was a matter of making sure that things wouldn't go wrong. By the time we get to the post-1120s, and this is an important turning point for those who are not familiar with this moment, 1120s, the Jurchens come in, they occupy Kaifeng, they take out the archives, they also move tens of thousands of people, many others flee south. So this, from a political perspective, this is a moment of crisis. From a socioeconomic perspective, historians not entirely agreed, because it seems that demographically, economically, the North recovered relatively quickly. But that moment gets kind of stored in a cultural memory. And it's referred to as Jingkang Zhi, the shame of the Jingkang period. This idea that the whole North and the capital had been lost to the Jurchens was one that set the mark for the century and a half that followed. So what we see here is sort of the first, one of the many examples in which this line of Sima Guang, this observation that Chinese history had been mostly a history of multi-state rule, gets remembered in the post-1120s period. And there at the bottom, I will show it in a minute, on a stele that is actually in some ways meant to show the opposite. If you look at this, it's a chronology of Chinese dynasties, any genealogy, whether it's an intellectual genealogy or a family genealogy, it's meant to show legitimate succession. It's meant to show continuity. There are some exceptions, perhaps on the left and on the right, there are these times of multi-state rule with many dynasties that present somewhat of a problem, but they're integrated in this model. But when you look at the bottom, it becomes apparent that for the Tudor who first devised this model, there was a tension. That at the time, in the Sovereign Song, this threat that Sima Guang in 1061 had sort of alluded to had realized itself again. Again, a time of multi-state rule. We no longer find the full context of the memorial, the sort of more reassuring lines at the end, we have done well in the Song, that all is dropped. The bigger question about the fact that there have only been 500 years or so of unified rule, that is the one that gets problematized. I said I wanted to make a point about transmission history. When this stele was put up, it was put up in the Suzhou Prefectural School for those who were attending the schools. It was for a literati audience, not necessarily those serving at the court. It had initially, it was put together by Huang Sheng in the 1190s to teach in a lecture to the then reigning emperor Ning Zhou. But when he got home, his family copied it, some of his friends then copied it as well and set it up in a prefectural school. There are also printed editions of this. Actually, the only surviving examples are now Japanese copies dating from around the 13th century as well. So we know that this discourse reached a broader audience. And again, we look a bit further when we, towards the end of the song, look at the noted encyclopedist survey of Chinese administrative history. He actually only quotes this one line. So he ends his survey of administrative history with this observation. In the last 1700 years or so, there have only been 500 in which we are united. So it sets this up as a problem for a cultural elites, the literati, to deal with. For me, it also sort of was a starting point to reconsider the importance of this moment when the North was taken over by the Georgians, when the Song had to withdraw to the South. This is typically seen as a moment of certainly in nationalist Chinese historiography, of shame, of sort of a small court, Xia Chaoting. Social historians have, since the 80s, done a lot with this. They have seen that this has been a defining moment in the sense that there's a transformation in the strategies by which elites perpetuate themselves. And up till this point, and I think they have a good argument to make, slightly simplifying it by saying up till this point, but we can say that if we look at Tang political elites, they tended to be predominantly settled down in the metropolitan areas, the capitals of Chang'an and Luoyang. And Nick Taggart has shown that this is a trend that lasts well into the 9th century. We look at the Northern Song, a similar trend resurfaces, that political elites, again, focus on Kaifeng. They are no longer simply an aristocratic elite, but they certainly focus on getting jobs through networks in the capital. Social historians have demonstrated that that changes after the 1120s, that elites, first of all, expand in numbers through the examination system, but they also settle down locally. They focus on becoming sort of brokers within their own communities, in part because options also become lesser. But what about political communication, political participation? I'll show this at the level of institutional history, legal history, and then cultural production. And that's when also we get to the digital component. Then in fact, we might see the opposite. That we may see, when we look at social history, a contraction, for example, of marriage patterns, that families that we know of through the record tend to marry more locally within the same prefecture or perhaps within neighboring prefectures, but not long distance, as they tended to do in the Tang and early Song. But when we look at information exchange, we find, I think, and that's what I hope to show, the opposite. That perhaps in part because they were settling down locally, there was more of a need to stay abreast of what was happening in the capital by connecting to people living in various parts of the Song Empire. So I tried to trace this in three ways. First, by looking at institutional history. And there, I think we can say that if we look, I'm sorry that this sort of looks crossed out. That was not the intention. It's just multiple monitors showing. If we start in the Northern Song, we can see that actually in many ways, the attempt to centralize control over all sorts of institutions, also information in particular, is in some ways, it exceeds what the Han and the Tang had done. A good example of that would be when we're in the case of information relating to local jurisdictions as well as the court, is that in the song you have something in the tongue you have something called jinzouyuan. At that point, we would probably translate them as capital liaison offices. These were set up by local or provincial governors in Chang'an to gather information about what was happening at the court. And so the earliest court gazettes we have, the sort of what people have typically seen as sort of the precursors of newspapers in the Chinese case, the earliest examples we have date from mid to late Hung and are examples that come from military governors trying to get information about what was happening. So they were gathering it themselves and then relaying it to their own administrations in the provinces. By the time we get to the late Zhou, so the precursors of the Song and then the Song itself, there no longer are multiple capital liaison offices. They use the same term, perhaps confusingly for us, but it's now one institution. It's, you might translate it as the memorials office, because the idea is to channel anything that comes up and anything that should go down to the prefectures through this one institution. That works on paper. But when we move into the late 11th century and the 12th century, we note that those sorts of institutions, of course, do not work the way they are intended to. And we notice that, for example, in the legal literature, then there are complaints about spies being paid to infiltrate into those offices, get information out, publish it commercially also in the capital, the xiaoba, the short reports, and relay it in some cases much faster than the official court gazettes back to the provinces. These sorts of reports gather in number and also in urgency as time progresses, suggesting that indeed the expansion of the numbers of people sitting examinations, there's a demand for that sort of literature because questions get asked about administrative problems necessitate sort of an interest and also the willingness to pay for that sort of information. There's actually, in the Song Pai Yao, we can find examples of what those working in the memorials office who are willing to send information out could expect to be paid for information that they shared. At the legal level then, sort of second row then, we find a similar trend. And this is in some ways sort of what got me interested in this project. On the one hand, look at some history, what we've seen in sort of book history or the cultural history of writing is that censorship, there are many instances of it, and particularly some famous instances of it. Sushi is a good example. And there certainly is a lot of legislation on material that should not be circulating. But on the other hand, we have the opposite. We sort of have a bit of a paradox that the sorts of materials I showed at the beginning, these commercial reproductions of archival compilations of court gazettes, those were things that should not be circulating, but many examples of them either exist. In the case of court gazettes, we don't have surviving examples, but we have a lot of secondary discourse about them. People writing poems about having read the court gazettes and their reactions to particular kinds of news, or people writing letters reacting to appointments or demotions of people, and so on. So dealing with that paradox, I think, shows something that we don't only see at this moment in time. I think we see at other points in Chinese history as well, that oftentimes censorship was focused on people who were already in trouble for other sorts of reasons. Xuxia is a good example of that, and the other cases we can think of are similarly people who were targeted because they were already in trouble. By and large, if we look at the behavior or the way in which legal regulations were or were not acted upon, we find that the court tended to acknowledge the fact that these sorts of state-related materials were circulating and being produced by others outside of the court. A good example of that is when the Song, the Sovereign Song Court, is trying to reassemble its own archive, because the archives from Kaifeng had been taken by the Jurchens, at least that is the story that we have been told. The approach they use is to send out copyists and reward the families who are willing to allow their copyists to copy the material. And so they're not confiscating it. They tend to acknowledge the fact that, yes, families have gotten an interest in that. And by and large, I think we don't necessarily have to jump to the conclusion that this is because, well, that's what pre-modern states could expect to do, that they don't have the resources to go to implement whatever regulations they come up with, perhaps. But I think there is also here something else, that is that by and large, the fact that elites are interested in court-related materials also has its benefits. It keeps the focus of debates very much focused on the court, and it, in many ways, also supports its authority. Now, thirdly, and this is mainly what I focused on, is the history of cultural production itself. I've already hinted at in the beginning that whereas when we look at maps, military geographies, archival compilations, or just single edicts, court gazettes, the court was a predominant publisher of that material up until the late 11th century, that for most of these genres changes to the realm of literati production and also consumption. So there were two things in this process that I wanted to particularly underscore. The first one I hinted at with the map, and that is that when we look at sort of the tone or one of the dominant themes in the literature that is produced in this way, is that they serve a mobilizing function. What I have here is the table of contents of a historical atlas from the 1130s, from which you saw a page in the beginning as well. So it traces Chinese territories throughout time, but reinforces this idea that there is a continuous shape of what the Chinese Empire should look like. And this is actually what I was working on when I was here in 2006-2007. So I found memories about this time as well. This is the way the Song Empire itself was imagined, as sort of an administrative territory, where you have many routes, the equivalent of provinces today, and the text sort of describes what those are in, of course, a somewhat anachronistic way. I sort of later on worked with Wim Blokman's European historian to sort of get an idea to what extent might this tie to sort of diverging imaginations of empires, and particularly also the classical legacy of empires. And this is probably, this is sort of a European map dating from roughly the same time period, slightly earlier. Although actually the Song example does go back to the early 12th century as well, so it was a later introduction. We have about the same time period, and this is probably, at least in his view, I have to take his word for this, the most detailed map of Europe you can find in medieval European mapping. The story changes, of course, once you move into the area of exploration. But at this point, this is one of the more detailed maps. And what you see, essentially, that this may not be immediately evident of you, typically European medieval mapping was based on a cosmological model of Asia, then Europe, and Africa, and very much the Christian idea of Jerusalem at the center was sort of the guiding principle there. Here we only see the European kind of part of this. You have Rome, I don't have a pointer here, and I cannot just show it here, but if you look in the right-hand corner there, you see Rome, that bigger church, then sort of underneath it you see the Alps that connected to the Frankish kingdoms that are all mentioned separately as well. You have sort of the Rhine separating east and west there in the middle. Perhaps with some foresight, you will have difficulty finding Britain in this picture because it's somewhere in the water there, right across from Flanders. But the point this is getting at is that in Saint-Omer, where this was done, this is part of an encyclopedic project as well, the vision is very much one of perhaps looking back to what the Carolingian Empire may have looked like, perhaps pointing also to a situation of sort of mobilizing people for the Crusades, but it's very much a vision that is based on a common idea of a Christian worldview, but not one that translates that into a vision of what an administration of a united place would look like. And that even though we also have examples of cosmology in the China case, their cosmology is very much tied also to an administrative vision of what the Chinese territories were like. So that's what I meant with an imperial mission. So a lot of this literature goes to the Huang Huifu, think about recovering the northern territories. But I was also interested in getting a sense of the geographic scope, the social makeup of the networks through which this material may have been circulating. To put it perhaps in other words, I was interested in the reception history of court gazettes, of maps, of the material I have been referring to. And that in some ways was difficult to do, because the secondary discourse we have on this appears in genres that are more difficult to handle and that have also been far less well covered in the secondary literature. I'm referring then mainly to notebooks and also letters. And it is no coincidence that it is also exactly at this point in time, in the 12th century, that these genres also get produced in much larger numbers than ever before. So in the case of notebooks, we have a couple of dozen from the Tang and Five dynasties. We have hundreds for so. And even though there's some debate about exactly how you define a genre like that, and there's also some variation in numbers, by and large, these go from about 400 to 700. So this is, we're talking about a significant difference, a significant increase. Also, very significantly, most of these now, many of these, I shouldn't say most, many of these we can document were circulating in print. And print takes off also in the 12th century as the medium through which to circulate this material, not because the technology was new, it certainly wasn't. It was already around at least in the 8th century, perhaps earlier. But it becomes used for all sorts of genre at this point in time because there is a readership. And there is a literati audience that is using it in part also to document their own interests. The problem I was running into, of course, was also a methodological one. When I was reading through notebooks, I think many of you may have gone through BG or diary kinds of literature, it's very fragmentary. It's very difficult to keep track of what is the common thread or what lies behind, what are the communication networks that lie behind this piece of work. And so that's when I started thinking about doing this in different ways. In the first instance, what I did, this is a later result, but I sort of manually encoded the text itself. So when we selected about 8 of these notebooks, and sort of each time when in an entry somebody said, I heard from so-and-so this, or I read this in such a book, or by in the book authored by such and such a person, I encoded this, and because we are very, very fortunate in the case of pre-20th century Chinese history, I should say, I could link this to existing biographical databases as well as historical geographical data sets. That meant that for every person that I was annotating, I could also then find where they lived, where they had worked, who their family members were, what they had written, if that was included in the China biographical database. A variety of such kinds of information. And so after having done that now, so with the book, this site will also become available. You can look at the text, but also explore everything that I think I found it. So you can look at the various authors or conversationalists or art collectors and book collectors that tagged, information about them from China biographical database, so you have full text view, looking at the table view. You can use this as a database, you can filter it by time, because time is actually very significant here. One of the findings by doing this in this way was that the communication network of the people we included, Wang Mingqing, was not a very significant person, but that's what I was after, was mostly focused on contemporaries. So even the case of authors, he was mostly citing people whose lifetimes coincided with his own. And that was of interest because It meant that there was no canonization effect that we might have expected. Some of us intellectual historians of the song is that they would focus on certain people, like some of the Neo-Confucians who were coming to the foreground. That was not the case. Literati in notebooks tended to display a broad network. And in the case of whom we've seen 354 people, and most of whom were contemporaries of various kinds. But we could also map that information. We could map the, as long as that information was available, of course, there are limitations. The prosopographical database is not complete, and it's not always correct. That's another issue. But you could supplement, and we did this in some ways as well. But what you could see, this is Wang Mingqing, that's a heat map, is that at the very minimum, when we only track the native places, we're not even looking at where people worked, but only tracking the native places of his informants, it's very clear you should include the purple there as well, that we're not looking at a local network. We're certainly looking at a supra regional network in this case. We can zoom in, we can here link to the people who lived in those particular places, so this can be reused for other purposes as well. You can define it by times, if you only want to see people who lived at a certain time in that region, you can go back to that. You can also export the information and use historical geographical data sets, which are also made available through the Harvard Historical GIS profiled here. This is an approximation. It's based on Hartwell's own information, which has been critiqued rather heavily. But the idea is that you can then put this in the context of provinces, the way they looked in the Southern Song. And when you look at it that way, you could look at the postings information, it's clear that his network actually included every single route of the Southern Song Empire. But you can also just look at this, you know, who are they talking about? This was interesting to me as well, so you can look at, across all of these notebooks, who are the people who get mentioned most, and then go back to the primary sources themselves. And there it's also very obvious that BT are ego documents. They mostly refer to their own experience and their own notebooks and what their dad said, and only in much smaller measure do they go to sort of more cultural icons. And I think that's a very, very significant part of the sort of the literati persona that is being constructed in notebooks, that it's somebody who's embedded in a broad network who isn't necessarily tied to a particular vision or a small group of people. This is this was the idea, so we wanted to, or I wanted to make sure that whatever I was claiming about the scope, the geographical scope, but also the social makeup, which is increasingly none of us holding informants, could be tracked by anyone who wanted to go to the notebooks themselves. And this is something that you can now do. So if as a graduate student, you're working on your archives, it's good to think about perhaps including this with your publications. But then it also struck me that doing this manually was a rather laborious process, and it was not always fun. I also taught some graduate students how to do this, but you're essentially encoding IDs that you then have to get from a different database, and it doesn't look great. And given that we had China biographical database, and that we had the historical geographical information, I figured that it might make sense to try and generalize this idea and create a platform that would allow you to use the existing dictionaries to mark up your text in an automatic function. With the caveat, automatic doesn't mean perfect. You still, after having done it automatically, you still have to go in and curate your information. But what you see in front of you is Markets, the platform that resulted. And that allows you to upload any text in fantasy, in classical Chinese, traditional characters, works best because the databases we work with are also, and I think this just makes sense for pre-20th century texts that you use traditional characters. By default, we will mark up places, official titles, person names, also alternate names, so not only Hilde Weerdt, but also Hilde. And we convert time references as well. But it has developed from there to include also, if you have your own dictionary, plans, for example, book titles, whatever it might be, you could work those as well. Or you can do an analysis based on keyword, let keywords come out of the text itself. So we have included a module that allows you to do that as well. It's a reading platform in part, so you can see that we have a variety of online reference sources that allow you to simply read your text. You can translate with a comment function, but you can also export it and do the sorts of mapping exercises that I showed before. So I'll talk more about that in the workshop, but I just wanted to give you a preview as to where this actually came from. But also, I mentioned in the very beginning that I wanted to say something about scaling, and this is a good moment to do. What I'm showing here is a part of my reading of the correspondence of Yang Wanli. Yang Wanli is known as a poet who wrote about daily life, was interested in New Confucian, but not particularly famous as a New Confucian. And I wanted to sort of go down a notch from the broader picture that I had painted in this book to sort of see what, you know, what can we say about the impact that a person had in the 12th century on his immediate environment locally, but also super locally, perhaps at court. And then compare that with a medieval European case as well. So, but when we started doing this also in the undergraduate seminar, the idea was not so much to do what I had done with the notebooks, that is to use fragments to build up a picture of a communication network, but the opposite. To start with 500 letters, in this case, his private collection is slightly under 500, and then to zoom into the moments that were most interesting. And that is oftentimes a challenge for, I think, those setting out with a project, particularly graduate students, to find the sources that are of interest, because most of the databases we use these days are not focused on making your where would I put it? To make information easily retrievable, to simply give you the results. What the idea behind this is that if you're interested in places and people, in topics, political thought in my case, so I can put those in as well, I can get the letters I want to see. And I can, after I've done this initial markup, I can get a network of the places from where to where was Yang Wanli sending letters. And this may not be immediately obvious. We're now linking, once you've done the markup in Marcus, you can export to Palladio, which is a visualization platform developed here, to explore your collection. If you see the big dot in the middle, this is when Yang Wanli is at home in Jishui, in Jizhou. He's sending mostly letters, in that case, to the court. So as somebody who is in retirement, supposedly, he's still maintaining a very close connection to the court. It's one of the things that you can see here. There's a timeline where you can also see what years is he writing, what topics is he writing about. So this allows you to put the information that you have collected next to the information that you may get from other databases and sort of get a picture of, or context, perhaps, of the source base that you want to work with. So you have topics, years, you can do graphs in this as well. So if I want to see what the, to whom is he talking, or what sorts of people is he talking to when he refers to military affairs, to the recovery, this is a fast way of exploring your information. This is also, this is the final one, but immediately makes it clear, it gives you also a source critical interpretation of your collection. You immediately get from this picture that most of Yang Wanli's letters are going to people all the way at the top, you know, the counselors, the military council, and so forth. So this is the two different ways of scaling, one scaling up, one scaling down. I'm going to end with this, I'm just call it an experiment to do, perhaps deal with a question that we couldn't deal with in an analog world. At least I think it would be almost impossible. The 12th century is also known as sort of the time when factionalism becomes, you could say, a way of life. At least one Fortuner, a 17th century historian, made the claim that from the Song onwards, factionalism sort of becomes part of literati life. One way or another, you will have to deal with the fact that you have to network with certain people, which may just cause trouble with others in the political world. Now, we have three defining moments in the history of factions, referring to sort of, you might translate this as political parties, although the word is perhaps too loaded with European content to be useful. In the early 12th century, 1104, there's a very famous Uanio faction. 309 people were listed, and this is what you see on this cave inscription, as people who should be demoted, should not be entering politics again. In the early 1140s, we have another moment. Qin Gui, whose family still carries the burden of being associated with a counselor with a bad reputation, also enlisted dozens of people as those who show up in these surveys. And then again in the 1190s, Qin Yuan, 59 people, mostly those, at least that is the historical interpretation, associated with the new Confucian movement of Wei. Now, for a long time, historians have had different takes on what these proscription lists, these faction lists really mean. In some cases in the Yuanio, they have even said this is later historians' fabrication. This didn't actually happen. It was sovereign Song historians who wanted to discredit the late sovereign Song who came up with this list. And in some ways, there is actually evidence that the list sort of kept expanding over time. Others have said, well, it's pretty clear that there are some very famous people there, and probably focusing on, in this case, with Yuanyuan, Sima Guang, Su Shi, some very famous people. But because it's impossible to simultaneously look at 309 people or 59 people and to make sense of why these people might have been tied, I thought that it would be useful to sort of see, well, what did their contemporaries think? And now we can do that, because we have all of the Wenji for the Song were digitized. Qian Song Wen is a project was done in the, starting in the 80s in Sichuan University. So we can use that as a way to look at what contemporaries, or how contemporaries grouped these people. Did they see relationships between them? One way in which we can trace that connection is to see, are they mentioned in the same documents? So if I and Tom are mentioned in the same document, that creates a tie. So anyone in that list, so we did that for all three, 309 people, we run them through. The source base, we took the year of the faction, that the faction list was compiled, 30, and all authors who were sort of at the top of their career, you might say, 30 years before and after, all their work we included in our text. So it's not all of Qian Song Wen in all cases, we just wanted to sort of roughly cover the time period that would be relevant to the time when those factions may have been active. So this was the first experiment. We just sort of gives you a structure, then we get a couple of clusters. So at this point, we're not going to do more of it. Most of us historians, we also want to see the names attached to it, but it sort of confirms the picture. In some ways, we're familiar with Sima Guang, Su Shi, Han Jingjian, the big names. That's where attention clusters. We do the same with the 1190s, the Qin Yuan. I think at this point, the thing that should immediately perhaps strike you is that this is a much denser network. That many of these people were occurring together in documents offered by their contemporaries. And in some ways that confirms what we know, that many have seen the new Confucians as sort of a Puritan movement that wanted to keep people close together and then sort of monitoring each other's behavior, being involved in common projects and so on. Interesting also the one in the middle of the century, we did the same thing, but oftentimes with network analysis one assumes that, you're always going to find networks, you're always going to find things. Not necessarily. In the case of Qin Gui, we found that actually, in this case, most likely there were no connections between those people on the list, no significant connections, and most likely, at least if we base ourselves on the remaining sources, this was a counselor who was going after random people he held a grudge against. There was no agenda that was shared by those who were listed. Now, it was the first experiment. We had sort of just run through it, and there were certainly, and this is sort of something that comes with being involved in something of this nature, there's some discomfort with the fact that actually there's going to be errors in that list. There's going to be names that aren't actually names and so forth. But it gave me at least the confidence that there was something worth continuing, because there were the comparison between the early 12th century, late 12th century, as well as the fact that clusters were showing that we didn't quite know what to do with, gave me the sense that it might be worth continuing this. So we cleaned this data and then worked with a network scientist who helped us to see whether there were communities that tended to form clear clusters, that shared more of an identity as a way, perhaps to translate that into non-network science language. So what you see here is again, the Yuanyo faction. What is very clear is two that we still recognize, Sushis and Maguang. But then there's one, the pink one in the middle, with a list of people who most likely, and I as a song historian still have to interpret this, so this is sort of one of the uses of working digitally, it raises questions. It shows you the sorts of gaps that in the historiography we have totally ignored. Mostly politicians who actually turn out to be the closest community. If we use a different way of community detection, we take away the people who connect groups to each other. We find that actually the groups around Sushis and Maguang tend to fragment. They no longer form a clear community, whereas this one that we can't quite identify, or I can't quite identify, tends to remain, tends to have a stronger identity. So this is something that we have to follow up on. We intend to do this by looking what is it that these people that might connect these people in the view of their contemporaries? Is it they share the same native place? Is it that they were in office at the same time? Various sorts of things we will be looking at, and we will be going back to the text, because the nice thing about this also is that this will also show you, okay, which text do you go to find these connections amongst these people? And in many cases, it will bring up genres that, again, we have ignored, because no historian can go through all T of a given time period. We look at the late 12th century again, and we find a similar picture, a couple of groups that we can easily identify as scholarly communities. Another one that isn't entirely clear, but very interestingly, the opposite happens when we follow that same procedure. When we take out the nodes that connect these communities, they actually become one big community. So for 70% of those do remain in the network. To translate that, not that's of course my interpretation, is that it confirms in some ways what we have said about the Confucians. Is that there may have been different communities with different emphases, but they tended to be seen as a party, as a group that shared a common agenda in ways that other literati networks hadn't. Now, one thing I think that historians can be rightfully accused of is that we tend to like to see evidence that confirms what we kind of already thought, and this could be a case in point. So one of the nice things of collaborating with a more skeptical network scientist was that, well, he said, well, you also need to sample this, whether you need to see whether this is actually something that might have been common among literati anyway. Maybe in the 12th century people were connected because of the sort of things that I was talking about in notebooks, that they wanted to display a broad network. They wanted to, in contemporary language, have lots of Facebook friends. So we decided to do a sampling, and we could do this because in China Biographical Database we could easily find a group of people, about 109 of them, whose backgrounds matched those of the ones we had as on the list of the Qin Yuan faction. So we picked ones who shared similar kinds of office, who lived at the same time. 109 of them, and what we find is this. Somewhat disappointing in some ways, but also in some ways it did confirm what we found, is that most of those, 109 of them, actually a larger group, were not seen by their contemporaries as having very significant ties. Disappointing in the sense that, well, this is the end of the story. We can't do very much more with this at this point. We can't compare the networks between the two. But there will be other ways in which we can randomize this. I'm coming to a conclusion. I think that it is about time. But I wanted to go back in the conclusion. I've shown you three different cases of scaling sources, of scaling methodologies as well. To me, these all kind of relate back to the Sima Kuang's question that I brought up in the beginning. If we go back to the long way of Chinese history, it is clear what he had observed, the fact that in the last 1700 years up to 960, there had only been 500 of in which the Chinese territories were ruled as a whole. That story did not apply to the succeeding period. The Seven Song was actually the last moment in Chinese history when you had a lasting period of multi-state rule. From Yuan onwards, we get a different picture. There's still moments of division, but they tend to be very of short duration. And what I wanted to suggest, this is in part a hypothesis, of course, is that what we see in terms of the geographical scope of communication networks relating to government in the notebooks that I've shown, but also what we saw in the case of Yang Wanli, who kept close connections to what was happening at court, even when not in office, but also what we saw with perhaps the most localized of ideologies, the Neo-Confucians, who were all about local welfare projects. But in all of those cases, that we see that focus that remained on unified rule. Also in the case of, you could say that Neo-Confucians in some ways kind of brought a localized ideology to the top. This was very much a super local network as well. So this does not mean that the institutional reforms of Yuan and Ming were insignificant. They certainly were. But I would say that the collaboration that cultural elites brought to those regimes, and that's something that the story that goes back to the 12th century were also very significant in that process. And I'll open it up with questions.
So we're going to open it up to the floor immediately. I have four questions, but I'm not going to start. So who would like to start us off with questions?
Thanks so much. I had a question about the going through and sort of tagging the parts of the text. So was that done manually, or was that like automatically pulling out place names and kind of like named entities?
So I'm going to go through much here. So what I did initially, so what I did with the notebooks, this was done manually. So I just, actually first, the story goes back to two experiments. I used qualitative analysis tools at first, but those very quickly I abandoned because you couldn't integrate the databases, the China biographical database, the historical geographical database. And so I decided to go for the text encoding initiative kind of model, where you just take the text, go into a text editor, and I linked, I had, so for each person, say I have an offer, I can have an IP that I need that allowed me to link the text to China biographical database. And I could add other types of information that were of interest to me. But then I figured that this was a laborious way of working, that some of this work could be done automatically. So in this view, in Marcus, all of that is done automatically.
Cool, so it's just programmatic, it's kind of pulling it out.
Yes. The place names, the personal names. Oh, but the color coding kind of tells you. The red is the full names, the orange is alternate names. So it could be somebody's first name or another name that they use. The light blue is official titles, the blue is place names, and the green is time references. Those are default, but you can add on whatever other tagging.
There's a footnote question to this. Do you think that something would have been lost had you had the capacity to skip the manual phase of that and then move automate? Something that we often hear, I remember a colleague, Richard White, talking about what comes out of the experience of manually entering that actually is a phenomenal kind of hypothesis generating process, but that can exhaust itself, at which point then seeking out automated solutions makes sense, whereas there is a risk that if one jumps right to the automated solution, that we can bypass that kind of time that offers up interpretive possibilities? Or would you say, no, I would much rather have skipped
that
and go?
It's difficult to say, because I haven't sort of fully automated and nothing else. That scenario I haven't really been involved with yet. But I doubt that it's actually, and that's, I think, where people's expectations have to be realistic. When you use this method, it's certainly not perfect. It will do some of the sort of basic work for you, but you still have to go through and correct. There's automated markup, and then there's manual markup, and this is where you correct the mistakes, and you still go through. So to me, this is very much a a supplement. And I've seen some very recently, some very good examples of that, that it brings things in view that are in the background, because when we read, we focus, or certainly when I read, I focus on certain things that are of interest, and that means that you're also ignoring a lot of other things. And what sort of the marking up allows you to do is to sort of, let's look at the whole picture, let's bring things into view that we might ignore as readers. But in some ways, I think what you said about it makes you think through the process, that is the case. I mean, a lot of this comes out of, first doing it manually in a way. And it mimics the way I read these sources.
I have two questions. Thanks for this wonderful presentation. So one is on the way you translate the term, I believe it's BG, right?
Mm-hmm.
You call it notebooks.
Mm-hmm.
And I wonder, by doing that, do you think there's kind of a private kind of nature you attach to these kind of materials? And also, given the fact that you use the BG together with the letters, both, I mean, in this project, seems to me like they are kind of more private than the other kind of anthologies, Wenji, right? So is there a intentional distinction on this, or is it just a choice of word for BG?
Okay. BG itself, I think you could say written notes, you could say notebooks.
Yeah.
Cool. It seems to me that your question is more about sort of what is private about this, and I think that is indeed in some ways a confusing word to use. When I say private, I mainly mean, for example, in the letters, that there were letters or genres that were not associated with a function related to bureaucratic status, that you have other letters that were clearly written as part of you doing your job as an official. It's qi and shu weren't. Even though they could still be two officials and bring up official matters, one way in which you could make that distinction is to say that they weren't part of what that person was meant to do in their job. It is confusing in the sense that notebooks they weren't private in the sense that they were just for me and I was protecting them. They were shared media, and the same is true for letters. The way some of these appeared in print had very much to do with the personal networks within which written notes circulated. So in the case of Wang Mingqing, we have all the prefaces of the various installments he wrote of Hui Zhongru waving the duster. Shares it with a friend who copies it, hand copies it, that copy gets circulated, more friends copy it, and then they decide, okay, let's print it. So it very quickly moves into what we might call a more public kind of arena. So it's not private in the sense that it's closed off from wider literary access. These things tend to move out of that realm very quickly. Private in contrast to sort of what is part of official correspondence. Does that answer your question?
And my second question is, have you ever compared the picture we got from here to if we did a similar project on this kind of official accounts, like in the standard histories or this more official kind of exchange of information of memorials? And does that kind of, if we do a project through that kind of materials and kind of visualize these pictures of networks, does that correspond to the thing you just showed us?
I think that would be a great project. No, I haven't done it. I don't know of anyone who has, but I think that could be the sort of thing that you can work with. The methodologically this is becoming possible. For the Qing Shilu at Taita, there was a dissertation that showed how you can follow the course through which documents go. That by looking at excerpts over the course of 2-3 years, you can see how a document travels from one office to the next, to the next, to the next, and how what gets accepted and what doesn't. So, yes, that kind of work would be possible, but I don't know of anyone having sort of tried to do this in the digital realm. We have Silas Wu's early work, but not kind of in this sort of way.
Thank you
very much for the talk. And angle is that when you're writing a book, when you're doing citations and footnotes, can you just use like the results that you got from the search engine? For example, like you just typed it in a name or a time span and you get the results from the digital file, and those are like original from the database but not the original in books, like the paper books themselves. So when you're writing a book, do you think it's a problem with all this kind of citation thing?
Okay, well, two things. For those, for the notebooks, I always went back to the June Washington edition, which is also the edition I used for the digital version. So it's the standard text that I think most people would use in the field. Also because it's based on a Song Yuan edition of these notebooks. There are some cases where you might say, well, I don't have a copy of Song Kuiyao, for example. There's a digital version that actually improves upon the printed versions. In that case, you do refer to it. But I would never refer to the search result. You refer to the actual texts where you find the sources that you use information from.
I'll insert a question. I'm wondering, we were talking about this a little bit earlier in the morning, and you made reference to it here, but it seems as there. I was wondering if you could speak a bit more about the implications for the post-Jurchen invasion localization argument, because there's a really fascinating genealogy if you have from Hartwell to Bollheims to you, kind of, it's almost as if the third generation striking back against an argument that is born out of a certain set of methodologies, but out of this work and this genealogy, it now becomes possible to interrogate that argument in different ways. And I'm wondering if you can spell out more clearly what you think are the implications from this about the localism argument. And then I guess I'll throw in a second one, which is a sort of related of the sociology of delivering DH, let's say DH augmented or empowered talks, which is, I have the sense that if you were standing before an audience and you had said over the past, just using the mid-12th century factionalism set of data, if you had said, I just spent the last decade reading through every single one of the texts in a certain corpus, and I have determined that there were no real meaningful connections between these individuals. Therefore, I'm making the argument before you today that we need to think of this as a purge of individuals, you know, based upon that there's some sort of effect that, I was wondering if you think this is true or not, that there's some sort of effect that has on, in a certain sense, the time and energy and pain that went into that kind of qualitative deep reading, that somehow in the DH world, if you present the exact same argument with the exact same level of reading, just through different means, that in a certain sense that now historians say, because you often hear in a lot of DH talks is sort of the chicken soup argument. We knew that. It's like, well, wait a minute, did we really know that? Or and I'm wondering if I'm just curious about, you know, since you are one of the most you're at the cutting edge of this, and also you're one of the most sort of well-traveled and well-spoken of the participants of it. What has been your reception when you put forward these arguments that are arrived at through means that the audience might still not be familiar with?
Okay. Fair question. The localism one first. I will say that in the most the second volume of the Cambridge History of China, Omosong came out, where Himes writes the social history chapter. And I think there, I think he kind of shows how the argument has developed, where I think he's quite right, and it's undeniable that the localist focus is far more articulated from the 11, in the post 1130 period than it was before. But he brings in that perspective that I think was lost for a while, that localism does not mean the turn inward, that it doesn't mean, well, you know, losing track of what happens elsewhere. So I think for that generation itself, I think the argument has also evolved over time. But there has indeed been quite a bit of debate, and most recently Gisel Key, for example, who also shows that, well, when you look at local projects, local state agents are also very much involved, so that even at that level, that you know, we have to perhaps also think of state involvement in different ways than we did in the 80s. So much for that. So I do, for me, the importance was that when the material that I looked at, when you look at political intellectual history, it's very clear that even when talking about local issues, that is very oftentimes very much, very clearly articulated at a level of, we have to embed this at the top as well, so that literate tend to work in supra-local ways, and that's sort of what I wanted to kind of illustrate with this book. Your second question about how does this come across, I think it has changed over time, and I'm sort of losing my voice, but I'll keep going. But and it, one of the things that I find most interesting is that it's also different based on generation. And one of the things that perhaps to me was the biggest surprise is when I first, the first thing I presented in this regard, I brought in some historians from Taiwan and mainland China who are kind of near retirement now, and who are very much historians who've gone through entire Wenji, who've you know, done documentary history. Some of you might know Deng Xianan, Huang Quanzhong. And they get it. They can see the value of trying to put something in a larger context, because ultimately that's for some of us, that is the motivation, is that, you know, you try to place a more limited corpus within a much larger context to get an idea of, you know, what am I looking at, really. And so for the factionalism one is a good example, that Hong Kong just said, I want to come and look at this, because I've been working with cases and I want to see what this brings up. And so we have a little workshop where Charles Hartman, sort of another example of this, very textual-based historian, now Huang Kuo-chung wants to come and look at, okay, what comes out if you run this through all of TLT1. So there is actually also, I think for many, and in some ways, that is the specter of quantitative social history of the 70s and 80s that is still with us. And in some ways, that's perhaps a healthy skepticism as well. But I think that there is also the fear that this means that you're moving away from interpretation, that you're sort of focused on patterns and quantitative ways of looking at a text that have in the 70s and 80s, you know, led to some scarier projects as well. I think actually that if there's another way of looking at this, and this is actually one colleague who sort of said to me, this is the new Kao Cheng in a way. This is the new philology. So I think you can look at it both ways, and I think you get both kinds of reception. You get people who are very concerned about the fact that there is a return to quantitative methods as well, and I think in some cases some cultural historians have no difficulty with quantitative evidence. Roger Chartier himself kind of, you know, puts book history in quantitative context as well. But you also have historians who sort of see, actually, this allows us to do some of the work we've always done in new ways, perhaps sometimes more systematic ways. Yeah, two questions there.
Well, just a very technical question. So how do you deal with the place names in variant forms?
So at this point, we don't do our own gazetteer development. So we really rely on, and I should perhaps put the slide up again, because it will not be possible without the work of various, various people who have contributed data and their expertise. So for the place names, we at this point use China Historical GIS, and they have a new development of this that's called TGAS. There's actually something we're looking forward to implementing, a new API for this, where they do have, so for if you have a place like Hangzhou, its location changes over time. They have historical layers. We'll say, if, you know, from this period from this year to this year, this is the longitude latitude for it. Other years, it's somewhere else. And so, at this point, we use the default that in the next version, you will be able to say, I think my text is, you know, you should date it to 850, and then it will, as by default, also use the longitude latitude that's associated with that time for the places that you label. Should you want to override them, you can, because sometimes in your text it will actually refer them to a Hun place, and you want to, in your map, you might want to refer to where that place was in the Hun. So that's how we're dealing with it. But that information, that's always important to know, is very incomplete. It's Futan has been working on this for years, but has incurred long delays in delivering the data.
So, obviously, you know, having seen this grow from a small, you know, starter project, actually, you know, I used to be a student at Leiden, and you know, I saw this in the first version when you could like annotate a few texts. So it's really great to see it here in at Stanford, you know, with all these features. But it still, you know, still has like the same kind of obstacle in some ways, maybe, you know, and it will probably always have that unless we all come together and find a solution that can be applied across the field. So maybe there's somebody here who has an idea. The text has to be digital, right? Mm-hmm. And of course, for the Song Dynasty, that's probably like fine. You were mentioning a lot of it is actually already digital. But you know, for example, the material you were showing from that stone carving, that's probably very hard for an OCR model to read, right? So in terms of manual engagement, you know, that's probably actually still always going to require a human to sit there. Are you aware of any projects in terms of improving OCR? It seems like there's not a single like OCR method for classical Chinese, and maybe we should all, as a field, unite and build it. Because why do we need like
can the 20th century come?
Yes, please. Yes.
Yes. Well, and I think you're raising a variety, not only the OCR question, but the bigger question of integration is a very important one. That in some ways, I don't think that this should be something that stays the way it is down the line. This should be part of how, you know, any library sets up its research platform, so that you know you don't work with an individual database and then have to export things. It should be integrated in ways that you search across everything that is available, then explore it in ways that make sense to you, and then do your analysis on that basis. But there is a lot that needs to happen, and I think part of that is for people who have projects to come together and figure out where is the biggest need, what have we found so far, and collaborate. As far as OCR is concerned, yes, there is some work ongoing. In Groningen, for example, there's people working with a variety of languages, Arabic, Chinese, and medieval European texts, to use face recognition technology to identify, sort of at a character level, what does this most likely relate to? And if that probably, I think, is quite promising, that instead of just doing an analysis of the shape of a character, working with face recognition technology, so that when you see, oh, that looks actually like this one. So it looks at, you might say, the geometric shape of something rather than that its analysis is sort of composed of radicals or that sort of thing. But it's a long way from that being implemented in a way that we can actually use it, so that you could put in this DELI and then get something out. I think that's not going to happen anytime soon, because even with that, first of all, not applied, but the error rate is still very significant. So a lot of work still needs to happen for that to work. But actually, I mean, one example of somebody who has sort of tried to improve an existing OCR technology is Donald Sturgeon, who's C-Text. Extension, so he has curated text, but then he has a lot that he has incorporated from databases where you only have the image, and he has improved on Tesseract, which is an open source OCR technology, so that the results are actually better than they would be if you use that. But
there's also, I mean, something that is interesting that's come out of our earlier conversation today, but in the first two sessions with Paul Viertheller and Richard Jinso and Hui Long is, there seems to be in social network analysis, it is now, by this point, not surprising to hear that you have sat down with a network scientist, or in the case of Richard Jinso and Hui Long, genomic sequencing, bioinformatics people, because, and for community detection algorithms or for whatever it is. But in the case of OCR, it seems as if it still is surprising to a greater extent that someone is speaking to facial recognition software specialists, but not only at the level of character, but also of page layout. I saw a paper that came out, which I don't remember if it was for Chinese or for Japanese, but it basically took as its first obstacle the question of even knowing how the page exists on the page, and like where is the directionality, where are the subsections, and the way that it basically worked to the extent that I could work through the equations in it and some of the diagrams, is it blurs it. It blurs the page and basically turns it into blocks of, they look like fuzzy caterpillars across the page, and you don't want to actually pay attention first to anything even remotely textual, it's just simply structural, and then the system can say, okay, we now know that it's a bar, and then a bar, and so therefore we know that, and then you can come back out and say, okay, now run in this direction. And perhaps this is actually a kind of embedded Latin, non-Latin bias in the system that maybe, certainly medieval texts do need a great deal of help, but it can, let's say, that need drops off rather rapidly when you're talking about maybe Latin texts, and it actually still is quite important if you're talking about, even if you were to do 20th century, I don't know, Shunbal, the idea of multiple directionalities, multiple horizontality, verticality, and maybe that would be a place where we need to look, or who are the people that aren't working on text at all? Who are our bioinformatics people, the equivalent thereof, to sit them down with some of our texts and say, what would you do, not knowing
that
the
word? That is actually where some of this the more interesting innovations have come from, was a computer scientist in Israel who's interested in bringing Hebrew manuscripts together and who has developed technology that can bring, scholars have worked on this for generations, some of the results confirmed what they had seen, but some of them were entirely new. The way these texts have been unfortunately dismantled is that pages get distributed throughout museums and archives in the world, but based on facial recognition technology, he was able to identify which pages belonged together for a larger number of texts than generations of scholars had done. And it is indeed based on thinking about this from a non-textual kind of perspective.
I mean, just go, if you don't have to go back to the first page, I'm sure we all remember the Bouin Hui Fu, right? Even indexing that in OCR software, what's it going to do? Where does it stick it? Like, it sees it there in the margin. And of course, we would have this problem with older or even academic texts, right? If you have footnotes, OCR software typically just goes, what? No, where do we, and that seems like a really big problem, especially given that I know that lots of this stuff has been digitized and has been painstakingly entered by a grad student or whatever. Mm-hmm. But there's much more where we still have, we have scans, right? And I know Donald Sturge, I asked him the same question actually when he was in Leiden last year. But even those scans should be much easier to search through, right?
Yeah, it's future music in a way.
But for the transform, I believe it's born digital, right?
It was born digital, that's right. So that helps. We have far more reliable data for those.
I don't know, I thought that I should ask this question rather late, so I thought that it could be a nice wrap-up question. I mean, not that I have to be the last one. First, thank you for this wonderful talk, detailed, and I have to congratulate you on your accomplishment. I mean, it's by itself looks very overwhelming. So my question is that what new kind or what new type of knowledge this way of historical representation, or rather presentation, I say, bringing in? So you said supplement, for instance. Probably, I guess you were implying an increase of knowledge. So, I don't know. But someone like Derrida might remind us that the logic of the supplement is such that, this extra knowledge is both, this extra is nice and but also negligible and expandable, but in a way, essential, hauntingly essential, bringing something that becomes essential that you cannot think outside of. So I guess I'm trying to ask, what is the historiography that's specific to this type of digital technique of relating to or presenting historical data? So putting it crudely, I know nothing about China, So I am not, so the extra knowledge that you may bring about China may not be relevant to someone like me, but for someone like me, the kind and type of knowledge that you are bringing in by using this kind of a technology, I would be really interested to hear you more about this.
Okay, so your question is almost at an epistemological level, sort of. If you don't think about what does this do for Chinese history, what does it do in terms of how we do history more broadly. It's a big question. I think it's also sort of forces someone to make very ambitious sorts of claims. I'm not someone who sort of thinks that doing things digitally necessarily is will bring a new era of historical scholarship. I do think that it can allow for the exploration of questions at a scale which are nearly impossible to do, I think, in an analog environment. It's possible to do if you have an army of people collecting information over a long time, but even then, I think so. If I would have to, let me sort of rephrase your question, something, what are the benefits of working this way at a semiological? One of them is fairly basic systemicity, but you could argue, well, you could try to achieve that in an analog environment. But the other one is the multi-perspectival nature of working digitally. What I mean by that is that, so if I have a text, I can map it. I can do also statistical analysis of it. I can do corpus linguistics in that same, with that same notebook that I have. I can bring in prosopographical data. All of that allows me to look at this from multiple angles. That if I simply read through it, and that's perhaps your question, if I simply read through it, I cannot compute all of that as I go through it. And even as I reflect of it as a historian, when I write it down, all of those dimensions are difficult to grasp in an analog environment. But by putting it in sort of multiple views, you can explore what you're looking at in a wider range of dimensions. So I would say that probably is the main one. But I haven't gotten to certain other things that, for example, one of the things that we will be adding down the future is the comparison of textual editions, which is sort of another area. If you have, say, 10 editions or something, you want to trace overlap between text over centuries of time. It's again something that you can't do. At an epistemological level, what that allows you to do is to sort of, you know, do a temporal vision of, or write histories of concepts of writing of other phenomena that I think we haven't done in an analog form and that probably find hard to contemplate. And that's perhaps the other thing, that it raises questions that we can begin to think of questions that actually we didn't think about before because we didn't have the tools to do it.
Your question there, comments made me think of in Duxiu, whenever they've scanned a text that has vertical stuff, likely, if you're looking for a phrase, likely you're likely to find a text in which those characters occur in adjacent columns but have nothing to do with each other. And in terms of the optical recognition, just a couple of days ago in the New York Times, I think they're talking about Hebrew texts written in Aramaic on pieces of clay. In many cases, they were actually using some kind of, maybe it was related to facial recognition software to make out what some of the more difficult to read characters were. So that's going on in there. But the question I wanted to ask about your work is, I take it that what a small percentage of the texts that you're looking at are datable or dated. And so what I'm often interested in is did this guy and this guy, were they in the same space at the same time? Or, you know, where were they at in such and such a year and so forth? And databases can often hopefully help you with that. But what do you feel about the limitations on that?
Thinking about the future, that will become more easy to do. In that, for example, well, what I showed, sort of run all the names through it, you know, it will bring up any text where those people get mentioned together that would allow you to sort of see, okay, we're in the same place at the same time. But I was, what brings me to sort of a more of a future prediction, perhaps, even that's sort of not necessarily what I want to be doing, but reading a book, it's called Data and Goliath, about the sorts of conclusions that data scientists can draw based on information that you provide without knowing it. And simply, even your name is not in there, by correlating data that's collected from you, your cell phone, your medical records, your police records, whatever else, they can infer a lot about you. And by correlating it to other people who were there at the same time when you were there in that location, they can actually find out who you're associating with. And that's, even though that's not necessarily how they collected the data, but by correlating information from different places, different databases, you can make these sorts of inferences. And surprisingly quickly, actually, in this environment, of course. Going back in time, it's not going to be that easy because our information is far more fragmentary. Nevertheless, we have in Chinese history very large textual corpora to work with that would allow us indeed to look at different kinds of variables that would allow us to say, actually, probably those two people are together in the same location at some point. But it's in many ways that means that sort of, you know, the tagging, the using different kinds of databases, because in many ways China Biographical Database is great, but it's also focused on a model that was a 70s, 80s model of doing social history. You know, it tracks family, it tracks career, it tracks relationships, but relationships of a certain kind. We haven't, if you start doing relationships based on the text we have, you can find far richer information in your text, and once you've done that, then you could start thinking about making these sorts of inquiries that you asked for. One example that I showed that we actually can do at this point, based on sort of modification that we did of China Biographical Database, if I have a person in my letters, I have Governor Chen, writing a letter to Governor Chen. Who is Governor Chen? Right? Mm-hmm. It's very difficult to do in most cases. So what we do now is that, and this goes back to the multi-perspectival point as well. One of the advantages of having databases is that you can query across various variables. So what we do now is that you put in, I have a Chen who's a governor roughly in this time period, or I might have an indication of which place this person may have been, and it will list for you all the options that we can find in the database. And then you can start reading about them and make a decision as to who this would most likely be. So it might be a way of identifying whether people know each other, even if you don't.
I'm actually putting together a list of, based on stuff I've done over the years, putting a list together for Michael Fuller of individuals mentioned by four different Song Dynasty poets. And what I put in is where the person was when the mention was made, and the year of the poet, is at least to some degree, they're all datable or dated. And how much of that is already in the database?
One of the things that we're trying to do now is to model biographical information, because they're actually a very strange genres. The Mujimi, the Niampu, you get a year, you get this person, it's this one, you can very quickly get that out and map it, but it hasn't been done, essentially. So that would be, this is, China Biographical Database, again, was sort of generated by somebody really wanting to do a relational database with certain types of information or certain types of social questions. It wasn't generated with this idea of, let's look at, you know, somebody's life and put as much as we can, or make as much as we can discoverable within the text itself. And I think that's sort of the new model of thinking about it, that you make databases out of texts, the embedded in the text themselves.
I have a question about the methodology here, which was related to Professor Sajin's question. So one of the things I think the potential peril of doing a project like that is the precision of the data points. Of course, yours are a lesser problem, but some, you know, say economic data can be a bigger problem. But for instance, like Professor Sajin says, the year, you know, when this letter was written, it's very difficult to identify, even in future. Even in future, because we don't have the necessary information to identify the year or the date. A second thing is like the idea of proxies. For you are using like these, say, the these people's names being mentioned in the same text, indicating they have a certain sort of same belong to same faction or have certain same kind of connections. But sometimes maybe enemies can be mentioned in the same text as often as friends. For criticizing. Or you know, there's also other kinds of, you know, relationships that does not necessarily indicate they belong to the same faction or same clique or things like that. So how do you deal with that idea? So you're using basically this to proxy as a proxy for that.
Yeah.
But there's always a kind of a translation issue between those two.
Can I answer just a smuggle in an omnibus bill? This raises the sociological effect of talking about a DH, that in a certain sense, we do this, I feel like we do this anyway in qualitative analysis, but there's something about DH that puts it in stark relief that raises questions that maybe get a pass in qualitative analysis. But I don't know.
And that's good. I think that is true. But I think that's sometimes that's good. I think it is in general. If you call it a field at all, it's very self-aware for that reason, is that people jump on the bad examples, for example. Well, but we don't jump on the bad examples in a regular journal as we might do in this particular case. But your questions are very good ones, and that's, first of all, sort of the one about how do you determine the year, that we always, we're embedding reference sources, and so all these reference sources that we had in print and that you had to sort of where they pull off the shelves, and you might kind of sometimes you get too tired of it, so you don't search it. Now we make those available in a way that allows you to look at them in, as I sort of said before, multi-perspectival sort of ways. You can make different kinds of correlations. But it does mean that interpretation is always necessary, and evaluation of your sources too. So the Nyanpo example that I gave is, I base my years for my letters for Yang Wanli on what I can find in a very well done edition of his Wenji and the Nyanpo that have been written for him. In some cases, I don't agree with what they have, the conclusions that they have drawn about a given year. But in many cases, I trust their opinion better, because these are people who have gone through the entire collection and made those decisions on that basis. But it's, yes, there is a dependence on other sources when you do this sort of work. Your question about relationships is also a very good one. And that's one, if you bring sort of emotional quality or the semantic value of relationships into the discussion, it's very hard to do, first of all. That's something that we would like to do, but we actually have to find sort of ways of doing that. For example, five relations, I get mentioned in the same document as Tom, but also as Dan and as Mark. You have emotional terms associated with it, but to which relationship would it apply? That's still difficult to decide on that in an automatic fashion. We have done one experiment with this, so it doesn't mean that in many cases, well, you find something interesting, you go back to the sources to sort of follow up on that in more traditional ways. But there is actually some ways in which you can, find anomalies, and this is sort of one of the things that is valuable in working with data, is that it throws up things that you won't pay attention to otherwise. One example of that is that what I didn't show is that also for Wangmin Qing's Way to Lu, that notebook, we marked up all people and relationships that were embedded in that text as well. And there are only four people who have what we might call exclusive relationships. That is, there are a lot of people who only get mentioned as in relationship to them. They don't have other connections. And those people tend to be authoritarian counselors, because they most likely are people who actually, they recruit sort of what we in the traditional scholarship have called the new men who will be loyal to them but are not tied into other kinds of networks. And so when you then, you find these sorts of anomalies, the people who, or at least not the people who have these sorts of relationships, but the targets of those relationships, you look at how they're described in the text, that sort of they're people of a certain type, or at least from the perspective of the author, they're people who get angry easily, or who kill people, or put them on the list, that sort of thing. But then you can generalize from there. Once you have that, you could say, okay, that's the case, those sorts of relationships, and it comes with a certain vocabulary to describe them. You could say, okay, now I'm going to look at how, whether this is something that recurs at other times as well. So you can generalize ways of detecting certain kinds of relationships, but it's certainly, I mean, that it depends on interest, and it's not an easy thing to do.
Well, then,
I want to thank you, and also in deference to your voice, which held up magnificently. But thank you very, very much for spending this.